a great opportunity if you were given to present another point of view at public meeting, or at least in a professional meeting. And actually, Dr. Jackie Evans is wrong, because when I went to the last GP meeting, I was told you can ask one question and you had your go, even when I was trying to point out that some of the facts were wrong. So I think people are not being, we will try and circulate our presentation, we will circulate our information. And I also find it disappointing that Jackie Evans tried to point out that a particular medium minor injury is benefiting a particular practice. What she didn't say was how you were benefiting.
I'm sorry, Dr. Mangali, I don't want to be,
But thank you very much for giving us an option.
I don't think it's acceptable in this process.
I think I'm going to have to challenge that, Chair, because again, one of the officers in the scrutiny committee has been suggested they're misleading the committee, this time from Dr. Mangani.
Point of order, Chair, point of order. You've just stopped Dr. Mangani speaking. Can you use same as Simon, please?
Yeah, I think that,
sorry, Councillor Norbury, but I thought we were coming to scrutiny.
Excuse me, you've got a chair at this meeting.
I apologise, Chair.
I'm going to have Councillor Usher, please, if you come to the mic. And then finally, Councillor Frost, thank you.
Thank you, Chair. on behalf of the Children and Families Committee, I'd like to thank everyone for their honest opinions on this consultation as well. And I think it's particularly difficult on this issue because we've had a range of clinical opinions and it does seem to be quite bad on the view for this consultation. I mean, it's clear that everyone's quite passionate about building a better NHS, and I don't find it acceptable that anyone would come to a scrutiny meeting and be heckled for it, so I don't think that's acceptable at all. But I think what we all agree on is Dr. Fraser's point of the NHS being under a lot of strain. And services are under immense pressure. I think we disagree on the solution, which is the way to solve this is to maybe reduce access to walking centres. I personally have a few doubts myself. The new system is heavily based on the assumption that the extra GP appointments will pick up what the walking centres now don't, and that the new system will work as it is supposed to. However, what's not considered is that there's something inherently appealing about a walk-in service, and that if there is one available locally, those capable will go to Arrow Park, and those who are less capable may face a number of extra barriers when it comes to actually getting the right treatment at the right time. So I've got a couple of questions. Just more, can we guarantee that the number of appointments we create will meet demand? How do we square the fact that a large number of GPs, which this new proposal is quite heavily reliant upon, are against the proposals? And given that the transport situation in Wirral has been very fluid lately, can we guarantee that won't change in the near future? And how much influence does the CCD have in influencing a very comprehensive restructure of the transport system in order to meet this new service? I suppose a hypothetical as well is that if there were a system that maintained walk-in centre provision with the addition of an urgent treatment centre at Arrow Park, would that clinically be a better option than the ones on the table?
Thank you for those. So I'm happy to give a couple, and then Paula will come in a little bit more on the conversations with the federations around GP time. So in terms of the appointments, and will that absolutely meet demand? Yes, we've scrutinised and scrutinised the activity. And we do believe that what we put forward and shared tonight more than adequately picks up the current demand, and also still gives 650-ish approximately a week additional GP and nurse appointments. Same day urban access, recognising that any demographic trends, etc. So we do believe that the modelling will pick up a local offer. The last thing we want is people that other were necessarily going up to Arran Park. This is about trying to put a single front door on the Arran Park side for those people who need, absolutely need that level of urgent care. Or indeed want the option of a walk-in because we're offering 15 or 24 hours a day. So it's recognising there's a consistent place for people to go that supports A&E. Do you want to do the feds and the GP welcome back to transport?
Yeah. Excuse me, sorry. In terms of the opinion of general practice, and you referenced that 91% of GPs don't want these changes, I think we need to make sure that we're talking about 91% of the 270 to 300 GPs. I'm a GP in Wirral, and I was never sent a survey, and neither were a number of my colleagues. So I think if we're talking about, if we're making headline news, and as I said at the outset, I'm happy for difficult conversations, and I welcome surveys, and I welcome the intensity with which people are getting involved in this. But if we're going to put headline news out there, then we need to be accurate about what we're talking about. As I said, I'm a GP in Wirral, and I was never sent the survey, and neither were a number of my colleagues. So I don't know what 91% represents, and whether that's a true reflection of the 51 practices, which is about 270 to 300 GPs, and whether that's a true reflection of the actual overall proposals, or if it's a yes or no response, because I didn't see it. And so my plea would be that when we look at, when we take on board those percentages, and when we hear about these surveys, that we take them as, maybe with a little bit of scepticism, and say, are these truly reflecting the opinions and the views of all of the GPs in Wirral.
Last couple of points. With regard to transport, we can influence but not insist, but we've got a clear commitment to try to work collaboratively with Mersey Travel, local councillors and the council. We are responsible for commissioning transport. We've already had one meeting, there's already been a lot of mapping work done, and there's been some very positive conversations had in that first meeting and prior to that first meeting from both Mersey Travel and the council about actually wanting to understand what the inequities are and improving those bus routes. At the moment there's a single cost envelope, but they're very live to actually looking at what they need going forward. So we can influence but not insist, and we're committed to do that. I think, and then your point around the walk-in access and that being you know, quite favourable for many people. We've put on the information we circulated the other options that we discounted that did include. Could we maintain some walk-in provision for all ages, etc., and have the UTC and invest in the diagnostics that we need? And because the only extra investment is the 1.8 million, it's not a cost-cutting exercise, but it is within that cost envelope. The hours of opening for the local offer would be drastically reduced, and we put that in that Appendix 7. But we need to hear from people. We didn't feel that actually helped with helping A&E, the confusion about where you go, and didn't feel it was a robust community offer for a walk-in element. What we do believe is that if we can really get those GP nurse appointments in, as we believe we can, if we can get many of those available in those four community courses, actually it's about making a phone call and saying, I've got an urgent need that day, and giving the time slot to go in, as opposed to walking in and waiting. So it's very much about saying, we absolutely support a local offer, there's a different way of putting that forward.
Did you want to add something?
Yes, thank you, Chair. And just to conclude that, really, if you look in the data that we've actually sent you in terms of appendices 4, 5, 6 and 7, it demonstrates the journey we've taken to get to these options that we've put out for public consultation. As I said, I wish to reiterate again, there's still options for consultation, and we welcome any alternatives to them. But all stages, providers, key providers within the room, having those discussions and names, particularly in terms of July 16 and November 16, down in the Appendix 5 we have submitted to you, and we will continue to invite people in to have those discussions, providers of those services, as we need to shape this to be a success, whatever the outcome of the consultation is in terms of final decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. Councillor Frost, and then...
Chair, can I ask for a supplement?
Yes, very, very quick.
Yeah, I mean, I think whether the GP survey was sent out to confirmed all, you know, GPs or not, and we will contest that, but we just have the results that are in front of us, and you know, there have been disputes that have been demonstrated tonight. So how do you reconcile the new system with the fact that many GPs have actually opposed to these changes? Is that, that's still a relevant concern to me, as is the concern around transport, because the lack of ability to actually guarantee comprehensive measures that will suit this new model. On appointments and the need being met by the amount of appointments. Currently, it's quite hard to get an appointment, and many people ring and aren't able to get a same day appointment, or aren't able to be offered an appointment. I'm just wondering whether we've recorded the number of people who've called through and not been able to get an appointment, and whether that's actually been worked into the figures.
Really good point. I'm not aware, I will check back at the branch, but I'm not aware that we'd actually can't be able to count that at this point. But I would totally acknowledge that if we're going to make this a sustainable, robust offer, there are some key areas that we need to really grapple with and make sure they're effective and fit for purpose. Telephone access, getting through all those single point of contact with services is a key priority. That's one of those areas.
I would say if we don't have that figure, then it would be very premature, or maybe even not possible to measure whether they've actually will be able to meet with the current demand for appointment.
Thank you,
Councillor
Rocha. Did you have something that you want to come back on? Okay, thank you. Councillor Frost, please.
Thank you, Chair. I believe we're hearing an awful lot that you're open to discussion and you're doing a lot of listening, but I personally remain convinced that during its existing consultation process, with just the two options that are on the table, there is actually the opportunity for a meaningful listening exercise. I think we've heard a lot from councillors today, from members of the public, and from a variety of different consultants, and I'm not convinced yet that those opinions are being taken into consideration. As a result, Chair, and so following the discussion that's been made, I'd like to propose a motion which is a reiteration of the motion that was passed unanimously at the last full council, proposed by Councillor Pat Hackett. And I'd also like to propose an amendment.